Writing fast and battery-friendly phone apps is essential for making users happy, but for Android Wear, it's absolutely critical. My name's Wayne Piekarski, and today I'm going to show you some simple tricks to make your Android Wear apps more battery efficient. As we've discussed in earlier videos, such as this dev byte here, the Data Layer API provides a mechanism for Android Wear devices to communicate with a companion phone or tablet. The API provides data items, which implement data storage and automatic synchronization, and messages, which implement a faster but not guaranteed way of sending messages to another device. The first thing to realize when designing your application architecture is that your phone typically has a much more powerful processor and a much larger battery than your wearable. So the best practice is that you want to offload as much as possible away from the wearable to try to get the most battery life out of it. Another key part of the application architecture is that the phone has direct access to the internet while the wearable does not. Imagine a scenario where you're building an app to show weather updates on a wearable. The phone will need to make the request to fetch the data and then send that to the wearable via the Data Layer API. There are many ways you can implement this, but if you do not design this carefully, it could perform poorly. So how do we go about implementing an efficient solution to this? One of the first improvements comes from changing how you wake up the wearable device. Rather than having the wearable wake up every 10 seconds or so and request an update from information from the phone, instead, you should allow the phone to drive updates to the wearable device. This simple action of keeping the watch asleep as long as possible will help to conserve battery life. When implementing the phone side, you need to do network requests for a weather update every so often. You should consider using the JobScheduler API for polling at a fixed interval instead of trying to write your own mechanism. The JobScheduler is able to combine your work with other work that needs to be done at the same time, so the CPU can be woken up more efficiently and saving power on the phone. Once you've made the weather update request from the phone, you may get back updated information. An important step to do here is to compare this with the previous information downloaded earlier. If there's no change to the information, you should not update the watch. There's no point waking it up just to tell it that nothing has happened. If you've detected a change, it's important to minimize the amount of data we actually send to the wearable. It would be a bad idea to send the entire weather query result here to the wearable, since it probably includes a lot of extra information. Instead, we should parse it on the phone and send just a single temperature value in this case. Remember, we're trying to minimize the amount of work done on the wearable. Even things which might seem trivial will add up eventually. So when sending the data to the wearable, how should we do that? If you have to send a large amount of temperature data for a time range, it might be tempting to create separate data items for each time and temperature and then send them separately. However, for each piece of data sent between the phone and the wearable, there are overheads added by the platform and the network. These overheads include headers for packets, acknowledgements per packet, and energy required for every packet sent, as well as activating the wireless hardware. When designing code to send data over a network, taking these overheads into consideration is very important. So by storing many numeric values into a single message, there will be much less data sent and processed than sending each one separately. So as you can see here, the results can be quite considerable. Once you've sent the data to the wearable, you might be tempted to add an acknowledgement to check it was received. However, if you're using data items, they're already guaranteed by the framework to be synchronized when the wearable is paired up. So you can be sure they'll eventually be received and there's no need for any further acknowledgement. However, if you're using messages, you might still need to check they're received since transmission is not guaranteed when the device is disconnected. So we've walked through an example of how to improve performance and battery life on Android Wear. And here's a summary of the key points. Only request network updates when you're certain there might be a change. Process the received data on the phone to minimize content sent to the Android Wear device. Only send updates to the wearable when things have actually changed. Combine multiple pieces of data together into single items to minimize protocol overheads. And finally, put as much code on the phone side as you can, since the watch should only be used for information presentation and simple user interaction. So these are some simple but highly effective ways of writing efficient applications for Android Wear. However, there are lots of other techniques you can use to improve your applications as well. So check out the rest of the Android Performance Pattern series to learn more, because much of it applies to Android Wear as well. And don't forget to join us on the Android Wear Google Plus community for tips and advice from other developers. So thanks for watching. I'm Wayne Piekarski, and keep calm, profile your code, and always remember, perf matters.